thank you so much for inviting me, and thank you for the amazing inspirational speeches we just heard. If you understand any English, take off the earphones, because I speak way too fast, and the poor interpreters are going to have a hard time. So make their life easier. So we seem to keep going from crisis to crisis to crisis. Financial crisis, climate crisis, health crisis, geopolitical crisis. What I want to argue is that to do what this conference is talking about, which is to go from ambition to action, we need to stop being reactive. We actually need a proactive way to solve our problems. Even the way that policy, and I'm an economist that looks at government policy, is designed is by definition reactive, because it's all about fixing market failures. And I think a really good first starting point to do what this conference is talking about, from ambition to action, is actually to ask ourselves, what is a new framing? What is a new design to actually take that seriously? And how do we, using the sexy word out there, walk the talk of stakeholder value, right? We need to actually produce, distribute differently. What does that mean? To do it in the way that Minister Baerbock was saying, which is through a value-driven approach. What does it mean to take seriously concepts of the common good? The common good is a very, very strong word. Pope Francis actually talks about it all the time. In economics, we think about public goods, but if you look in the textbooks about public goods, it's just kind of correcting for something that the private sector is not doing. There's no real common good approach as an objective. So instead of just correcting and fixing market failures and constantly picking up the mess, literally, of crisis after crisis, I think this conference really needs to be a call to action for change. And of course, that would have, you know, been just as strong of a call had this, had Putin's war also not happened. We were already on a very, very bad path. And, you know, the financial crisis, many countries are still trying to get out of it. The climate crisis, we know, as Greta Thunberg always reminds us, we just keep blah, blah, blahing. In 2019, just a couple years ago, Europe actually subsidized fossil fuel companies with $56 billion. In subsidies. 2020 of the COVID-19 recovery funds gone to energy companies globally in the G20 countries, something like 52% of that went to fossil fuel projects. That is hardly doing what the IPCC has told us to do, which is get moving quickly, because we have about 8 years left until we have an irreversible climate emergency. And this is, of course, why, again, Greta often says, when your house is on fire, what do you do? Do you sit there and debate? Should I stay? Should I go? What should I bring with me? You get out fast, and we are not moving at pace. But to move at pace, we also have to take care, slowly, to think about why we have done things so wrongly and what we need to change within our business governance, so corporate governance structures, but also policy governance, the governance of the state, which is actually very inertial often, not agile, not flexible, and constantly in that fixing mode. And, you know, to actually have a green transition, a proper green revolution, we need to ask ourselves literally what it means for producing differently, for innovating differently. Innovation isn't always good. It depends how we govern that innovation process. We see this, of course, today with the big tech problem in terms of issues around privacy and so on. It's not enough to fund digital technology or even the internet if we don't think about how to govern it for the common good. And I think what's really inspiring, Minister Habeck, if I can say, is the title of your ministry, right? It's Economic Affairs and Climate. And that is so important. These are not trade-offs. If we actually innovate, invest, and collaborate differently towards climate action, or to be honest, towards all of the Sustainable Development Goals, all 17 of them, we just had the UN Secretary General speak, there's 169 targets beneath them. They all require innovation, technological, organizational, social innovation. If we do that through a collaborative approach, if we do that even using the full capacity of our industrial strategies, our innovation policies, our procurement budgets, right? Something like 40% of every government's budget is just on buying stuff, procuring green services, green products, and really using all the levers that governments have, grants, loans, procurement, bailouts, to fuel bottom-up experimentation towards these social environmental goals, that can create economic growth. But only if we have that investment lens, and that's why it's really important, again, to go from ambition to action through an investment pathway collaboratively through public, private, and third sector civil society organizations working together in a different way. But you know what? We're not doing this. So let me just quickly remind you why this call for action is important. First of all, finance. The financial sector continues to mainly finance itself. Something like 80% of the finance that was created after the financial crisis went back to finance, insurance, and real estate. It didn't actually land on the real economy. It wasn't actually, the money creation did not happen side by side with real kind of fiscal stimulus packages that created new opportunities in the green, in the real economy for that money to land somewhere real, let alone the green direction of that green economy. And in fact, the latest findings using the Greenness of Stimulus Index, the GSI, shows that only 28% of G20 investment, so 4.8 trillion of the total 17.2 trillion stimulus announced during the COVID-19 pandemic, so announced in July 2021, only 28% of that is going into green sectors, with only 1.8 trillion, so only 10.6%, having any sort of net positive impact on the environment in green sectors. This is called wasting a crisis. The trillions that are coming out of the woodwork after we were told just 3 or 4 years ago there was no money, the trillions need to be actually directed towards improving our economy, towards making it more sustainable and inclusive. In theory, that's what build back better, build forwards better should mean. We're not doing that. Second, business, corporate governance, it matters. And there's different ways to do it. In fact, in Germany, you have, like much of Northern Europe, been implementing, not in a perfect way, but this concept of stakeholder value, right? You actually have trade union representatives on the boards, for example, of your companies. But globally, what we have is a huge extraction machine going on, something like $4 trillion, that's 12 zeros, just to remind us all, have been used just to buy back shares by the large corporate 500 companies, to buy back shares, to boost share prices, stock options, and executive pay. That's a lack of reinvestment back into the economy. And of course, that also hurts, for example, people who work in companies, labor, right? The labor share of global income, right? GDP can be broken down in different ways, including the share of all the different parts. The labor share is at the lowest it's been in modern capitalist history. That lack of reinvestment back into the economy, in human capital, in training, in research and development, in this large chunk that is being extracted for what we might call financialized purposes, we need to talk about that. And there's other ways that extraction occurs as well. Intellectual property rights, something that I would love to speak more with my German colleagues. Intellectual property rights, patents, are fine as long as they're not abused. But often we have patents, IPR, that's true upstream, so we're actually privatizing the tools for research, and we need lots of research for the green transition, but also for our healthcare systems. Too upstream, too wide, often used just for strategic reasons, and too strong, hard to license. How do we actually govern an innovation system or intellectual property rights for the common good? Well, that means limiting that extractive power. And Minister Habeck, you said the sun, it's a common good. Well, so is water. We managed to do a lot of, you know, problems with water. I'm going to be co-chairing with Ngozi from the World Trade Organization and two other people, including Johan Rockström, the new Water Commission, Beyond Water, Water is a common good. Well, we've managed to turn it into a private good, and we are hardly sharing it globally. So the sun, let's be careful. It's not just because we have a renewable energy strategy that it will be good enough. We've also managed to privatize genes. So anyway, so the other huge problem besides finance business is governments. I already quickly mentioned before, we have this really boring framing for what government should be, right? I mean, if it's just fixing market failures, it will always be too little too late. It will often not even have the capacity, the dynamic capabilities within public organizations in order to govern really difficult challenges, whether they be financial crises, climate crises, health crises, geopolitical crises. This massive outsourcing of government capacity, for example, to consulting companies, whether it's McKinsey, PwC, it's not necessarily the consulting company's fault. It's the question, why do we not understand public sector organizations also as value co-creating? Why are they just fixing? And if they are co-creating, if they have to govern these really difficult processes, what are the skills that are required inside? What's the subject area expertise that's required inside? And what's the, you know, knowledge about how to work with the private sector? What are the right terms of reference and good deals? So I just want to end with kind of a call for proper action around these issues. And I recently wrote a book called The Mission Economy, A Moonshot Guide to Changing Capitalism, where I lay out something that I think is quite useful for a conference like this, which is a moonshot approach. So 51 years ago, we went to the moon. It was hard. In fact, Kennedy said, we're going to do this because it's hard, not because it's easy. And think of all the policy speak today. It's about facilitating, making things easier. Taking on the uncertainty, taking on the difficulty, admitting that you actually require risk-taking, experimentation, sandboxing, testing policies. That is a very important first step. The second thing is the moon landing was not just public sector. It was guided by public institutions, NASA especially, but it required huge amounts of efforts by many, many different sectors, nutrition, electronics, materials, the software sector. And also that collaboration, which created so many spillovers, you know, baby formula, home insulation, camera phones, the software industry basically was a spillover, didn't just happen. They didn't just say, oh, let's go play together, let's collaborate. It was designed into the system. The first thing they did was actually change how procurement was done, away from a cost-plus technique towards fixed price, like a challenge, yeah, targets, but then very open on the how. They also, within NASA, this is so interesting, the guy who was running procurement, Ernest Brackett, said, oh, and we within our public organization need to be smart. We won't know who to work with if we don't have those capabilities. And he warned back then, if we don't do that, if we become dumb within our public institution, we will get captured by brochuremanship. Interesting, they didn't have PowerPoints back then, they had brochures. And they also designed into the contracts inclusion. They said no excess profits. This is actually going to require true investment, innovation, and risk-taking by all the different actors, so let's not make this into a gambling casino. So many of these points, I think, are incredibly important for what we're trying to do here. Redesigning policy with really bold targets, starting with the sustainable development goals, but turning them into really concrete missions, a plastic-free ocean, carbon-neutral cities, getting every single sector involved instead of having these static lists of sectors in a kind of top sector industrial strategy approach. Redesigning all the instruments, procurement, bailouts, grants, loans, to really foster that bottom-up experimentation. And on that, by the way, some countries are leading. I found it really interesting that in Germany, the loan that was provided to the steel sector by the KfW was conditional, so it's the public bank here, conditional on steel lowering its material content, which it did through repurpose, reuse, recycle technology. And it today is one of the greenest, along with Sweden's, steel sectors in the world. Not because they went to Davos to talk about purpose, but because they had to get one penny. Same thing with the French recovery funds, not perfect in any way, but Renault and Air France, to get any money from the government during the COVID recovery period, had to commit to lowering their carbon emissions. Now, doing that in such a way that remains open on the how is really important to really kind of stimulate that bottom-up innovation. But simply handing out money, subsidies, guarantees, or bailouts without that kind of conditionality is, again, a waste of a crisis. We need to really be redesigning the policies, but also reviving a true social contract in such a way that we have symbiotic, mutualistic public-private partnerships and less of the kind of parasitic type that unfortunately we've seen. So let me just finish on that. And thank you again for your wonderful speeches, for the invitation. But we really need to think of this as a way to redesign our capitalist system. There's different ways to do it. Everything that we currently are experiencing, which is problematic, including vaccine apartheid, where something like 80% of the vaccines are being hoarded by 10% of countries, there's nothing inevitable in that. That is an outcome of decisions we are making and also the relational situations that we have between public and private. We can reinvent it. We must reinvent it. Thank you very much.